Good morning. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Dr. Naseem. I'm a urology resident. We'll be discussing, since we have already started discussing the management of renal cell carcinoma, today is the second session of that series. We'll be discussing radical nephrectomy. Renal cell carcinoma accounts for 90% of all renal malignancies, one of the most commonest and one of the most lethal of all urological cancers. Since the last two decades, the treatment strategies have inclined towards more minimally invasive and conservative approaches. Nevertheless, surgical removal is still considered to be the most significant procedure. During the past decades, traditionally, open radical nephrectomy was the treatment of choice and was the standard procedure for renal cell carcinoma since Robson first reported it in 1969. It has largely been replaced now by laparoscopic approach, which was first performed by Kleeman and colleagues in 1990. The prototype of this procedure, as we all know, included the complete removal of kidney with its fascia, serota fascia, that is perifacial surgery, together with ipsilateral adrenal gland and complete regional lymphadenectomy. However, these additional procedures like adrenalectomy and lymphadenectomies as a routine have now become controversial. Although the inclination towards is nowadays is towards minimally invasive and nephron sparing surgeries, still there are some indications for radical nephrectomy in the era of nephron sparing surgery. For example, those tumors who are present in non-functional kidneys are to be removed in block. And if there is a large renal mass that is not amenable to nephron sparing surgery, or there are regional lymphadenopathies, or if there is associated venous tumor thrombus. Necessity of adrenalectomy. The overall incidence of adrenal mets in many studies has been reported less than 5%. Upper pole location is no longer a predictive factor of adrenal involvement. Only the radiographic evidence and perioperative findings should be the guiding principles. Like if you feel on perioperative findings that the adrenal is involved, there is a mass, or the facial planes between the kidney and adrenal gland are completely obliterated, those should be the indications, regardless of the tumor size. There are some guidelines, I mean, some sort of clinical indicators, although these are not black and white completely. They vary from patient to patient, but they guide with surgical practice regarding adrenalectomy. For example, if there is diffuse involvement of the gland by tumor, or the tumor is large size, more than 10 centimeters, or if they're surrounding extrarenal tumor extension, the probability of the tumor metastasizing into the adrenal gland would be higher, or if they're associated tumor thrombus in the venous system, regional lymphadenopathy, regional mets, or if there is a visible mass on imaging. The recent guidelines from EUA from renal cell carcinoma are also stressing the same, that do not perform ipsilateral adrenalectomy if there is no evidence of invasion. The American urological guidelines are no different. They are also stressing upon the similar fact that surgical excision of renal mass should only be performed if there is strong imaging or intraoperative evidence supporting your stance. Next is lymph node dissection, when and how extensive. Lymphatic mets, although are a dire prognostic sign, but should they be removed or not, or would they be adding any benefit to the patient in survival in terms of cancer-free survival or not, that is the point of discussion. Lymph node involvement is associated with 5 and 10 year survival rate of 50 to 30 and 0 to 5% respectively. But lymph node involvement is preliminary a prognostic factor. So therapeutic benefits of this dissection are controversial. Less than 20% of the clinically suspected metastatic nodes that were removed during lymph node dissection turned out to be histopathologically positive as well. So rest of the 80% were not positive histopathologically, although they had clinical suspicion. So the EUA guidelines suggest that the patient with clinically enlarged nodes only in those patients we should perform lymph node dissection, and that too only for staging purpose. AUA guidelines suggest that patients who are undergoing surgical excision of renal mass with clinically concerning regional lymphadenopathy, patients should perform a lymph node dissection for staging purpose. These five factors have actually been taken from two studies. One was performed in 2004 upon 1,652 patients. A retrospective data was collected from the patients who underwent radical nephrectomy along with lymph node dissection. And another study was performed in 2011, and 415 patients underwent surgery with lymphadenectomy. Both of these suggested that these could be the guiding principles for performing regional lymphadenopathy, these pathological factors. These studies suggested that the presence of two or more than two of these factors will greatly increase the likelihood of lymphatic mets. For example, these are large primary tumors, more than 10 centimeter, or the clinical stage is T3 or 4, tumor grade is high, or there are sarcomatoid or necrotic factors on histology. This is the assembled data from these two state studies that I've already mentioned. As you can see, the presence of two or more than two factors greatly increase the possibility of lymphatic involvement. How extensive should be the lymphadenectomy? The same study, 2011, this chart is taken from that, and it provides a mapping of the regional lymph nodes that are to be dissected and the probability of them being positive. For example, in right-sided tumors, the probability of pre-para-aortic lymph nodes involvement is 20%. And for left-sided tumor, the involvement of pre-caval nodes positivity is 7%. So these are only the guidelines which should help individual surgeon to decide how much or how extensive the lymphadenectomy should be. Although the traditional studies recommend that ipsilateral great veins, ipsilateral vessels are and their surrounding nodes are to be dissected from the crust of diaphragm to the internal iliac artery.
Just a word about lymphadenectomy. Sure. We are all trained and make our decisions on the basis of TNM classification. By decision making, what I mean is to know what is the proper stage of a tumor, and then according to the stage, what is the proper treatment for that kind of a disease. Now, there are again two ways of going about this issue. One is you always calculate something on imaging prior to surgery, and that is clinical assessment. By clinical assessment, you can see whether the lymph nodes are there or not, whether the tumor is confined to one pole or the other pole, whether it is exophytic or endophytic. And on that basis, if you just minus this picture of lymphadenopathy, then you are always in deciding two factors, always in a fix, whether you should go towards partial nephrectomy or you should go towards complete nephrectomy. Now, for the past maybe 10 years or so, what has been done is we are not properly addressing the problem of radical nephrectomy. We are not taking the whole definition into perspective. We are just going in for the kill of the tumor that is in front of us. We don't want to get away with the adrenal if it is in the immediate vicinity of the tumor. What happens is, after the specimen is being processed by the histopathologist, the N factor is minus because it is not there, because you haven't dissected it out. So how sure you are whether it is involved or not, since you haven't done lymphadenectomy. Now, this is something which is which has got wider implications if you want to practice the whole subject in totality. By that I mean to say, now there is a new adjuvant factor attached to tumor therapy, tumor of the kidney, and there is an adjuvant factor also. There are drugs available. Now, these drugs were not available, and the whole natural history of the disease process was not clear 10 years back. Now it is. So unless and until we revisit this problem of ablative surgery in totality, taking out all the lymph nodes which are palpable, which are seen on a CT scan, unless and until we take all the lymph nodes which you have described in the template, we will not be able to judge or decide whether they are involved or not, because you haven't taken them out. And the decision whether this case is for partial nephrectomy or complete ablative nephrectomy is always taken when you take into consideration the clinical picture first. So if this thing is actually masked, it's not in your vision, you will always be providing something which is a substandard, which is not according to the standard. So either we should shun this TNM classification for renal tumor, or if we want to believe in it, then we have to do it properly. So I'm criticizing the whole community of urologists, right? So we have got two communities attached to this subject. One is the medical oncologist, the other one is the surgical oncologist. The medical oncologist will always act upon whatever we have done as surgeons. Now, if our surgery is a little bit away from what is expected of us, then they will not be able to properly treat the patient, right? So I think this subject of lymph adenectomy with total radical nephrectomy should again be readdressed, should be revisited by us.
Sir, you say correctly, but I think the guidelines in case of RCC, they have misguided us. They have made lymph adenectomy controversial, whether to take out the lymph node or not. But in case of bladder cancer or testicle tumor, it is mandatory to remove the lymph nodes. Then we can properly access the lymph node.
You see, rules are for those who want to obey the rules, but the rules are for those who want to practice it for the purpose of giving something to the general public. Guidelines are for guidelines. They are not meant to just put your patient into the guideline. You always have the right as a physician or a surgeon to raise some point against it. So why not just raise the point against it? Because this is something which is scientific. This is not dogmatic. This is science. So everything which is a principle now can never be a principle tomorrow. You always have something to revisit. What my plea is, if at all you are misguided by the guideline, then you should correct yourself. Who will correct the guideline? Guidelines are not something which are divine. These are something which have been proposed by some people who have thought that this thing is proper on a larger scale. So the West is a data-driven society. So they always work on the basis of data. They thought that if lymphadenectomy was done in, for instance, thousands of patients, and it has got less than 1% of value, so they have just put themselves away from it. But now there is a problem. There is another thing coming up onto the scene, and that is medical oncology. What I am stressing at this point is, we are progressing. Since we are progressing, so the surgery has to progress along with whatever the other fields are actually going along with us. So if now there are options available in terms of new adjuvant and adjuvant, we have to address this problem again. Because if that is something which is left behind, it will be difficult for them, our medical oncologists, to just cater to this problem. Okay. Right?
So if lymph nodes are radiologically enlarged, 2 centimeters or larger, or if they are large on palpation while you're doing nephrectomy, they are to be taken out for staging to decide and to predict the further course of the patient's disease.
It's better to take out the whole template. Don't rely on your fingers and on your palpation. Maybe your fingers are sensitive, maybe they are insensitive. So there are very variations in surgeons' experience also. But if there is a template that has to be taken, come what may, then everybody has to take it out. If it is negative, meaning to say the lymph nodes are not involved, it's a good news. It's a good news for the patient, it's a good news for the medical oncologist. But if one of them is positive, it's a bad news, because this is something which is a stage progression. It is something which is beyond clinical stage. So this is a pathological stage. So for all purposes, scientific purposes, if you are doing it for radical prostatectomy, if you are doing it for radical cystectomy, why not for radical nephrectomy? Right? So for after 10 years, probably, we are coming back to the same issue. We have shunned it. Now we want to pick it up.
Taking out the complete template is also supported in this picture, as the ipsilateral renal vein lymph nodes involved are not involved in all of the cases. So all of that template is to be taken out, not less than 15 nodes at once.
Just to give another point and then you can proceed. For instance, again, there are certain messages which are given in, or they are relayed by guidelines. For instance, two or three years back, when the partial nephrectomy was done, it was propagated and a sentence was actually resonated that there is no point in taking the sample for frozen section. And anybody who was taking the frozen section, he was actually laughed at. And I was the one who was laughed at by my colleagues, that you are taking frozen section. Europe is not taking frozen section. There is no point in taking frozen section. What they were missing, and they were not telling anybody, was whenever they don't take frozen section, they always do intraoperative ultrasound. So what we are missing is something which is very prudent. It is something which is which can be done again and again. So West will not always go something with a click of a finger. They always do something with evidence. So if you put your evidence there, then they will always believe you. So if you want to put away something called frozen section, you must do intraoperative ultrasound. But you are not doing intraoperative ultrasound and you are not taking frozen section. So some of the cases have to be done again, just because the reason that 3 months after partial nephrectomy, there was something which is glowing on post-contrast study. And that is something which is a positive surgical margin. That is not the actual assumption when surgery was done, called partial nephrectomy. Right? So whenever somebody is doing something, he or she must be able to withstand all the criticism. Otherwise, you can't just hide behind, sir, guidelines. Sorry, you are not for the guidelines. Guidelines are for you.
Frozen sections or not?
No, sir. And we are not doing intraoperatives. Harris is there or not? So, I think... restarted from today. Right. So it's no harm and it's no shame if you want to just say that I have done something wrong in my recent past, for instance 2-3 years, and now as a group we all have to do something which is called self-criticism. If you want to have a better word, then that is known as self-audit. You always audit something which has been gone, which has been away from the actual line. So you can go either way, right side of the line, left side of the line, but please do something which is evidence-based. Now this is an era of evidence-based medicine. It's problem-oriented, but evidence-based.
Locally advanced disease involving surrounding viscera. Although the surgical implications of removing the kidney and surrounding viscera in this setup are now decreasing due to the recent introduction of targeted therapies and immune therapies, since in selected cases it is occasionally indicated in patients, although the patients presenting with T4 stage are less than 2% of the total picture, larger tumors are more likely to metastasize and invade rather than invading adjacent structures. That makes it less likely to go about this surgery with curative intent. Because surgical therapy is the only potential curative treatment, extended operations with en bloc resection like splenectomy, partial colectomy, or occasionally pancreatoduodenectomy is occasionally indicated. Renal cell carcinoma, along with other retroperitoneal tumors and hepatic tumors, has a proclivity for vascular invasion, and it occurs in about 10% of cases. The tumor, the thrombus in, growing into the venous compartments in the setup of renal mass comprises of two components. One is tumor thrombus, the other one is bland thrombus. So the tumor thrombus is actually the neoplastic cells growing into the blood coagulum and making it into a tumor itself. And bland thrombus results secondary to this blood stasis caused by the tumor thrombus. So they both can coexist. Although it's not a poor prognostic sign since the introduction of advanced radiological investigations and the heroic surgery that we are able to perform with cardiopulmonary bypass, etc., they have given us the opportunity of resecting this extensive tumor, no matter if it is extending upward to the renal atrium as well, and rendering the patient tumor-free. Aggressive surgical resection is widely accepted as the default management, and up to 70% of patients can be cured with renal nephrectomy and IVC thrombectomy. This is a classification chart introduced by the Mayo State Clinic, and most of you are familiar with it already. The tumor thrombus involving the venous system is classified according to its progression, Kevlar. The zero level thrombus should be limited to the renal vein. Level 1 is up to 2 cm, level 2 is more than 2 cm proximally, but below the hepatic veins. Level 3 is below the diaphragmatic levels, and level 4 would cross the diaphragm and enter into the right atrium. Mayo Clinic has also provided with a classification of bland thrombus, and that will help with the management of tumor thrombi. For example, if they are bland thrombus level A, that patient would only need a thromboprophylaxis in the form of heparin or warfarin later on in the life. With level B, infrarenal or IVC, that we can introduce Greenfield filters and prevent the progression or cranial migration of these thrombi, since they cannot be extracted completely all the time. The higher level of thrombus, as I've already mentioned, is not associated with increased tumor dissemination and distant mets, and is not a dire prognostic sign, no longer. But in the absence of metastasis, level 4 thrombi can also be cured with surgical excisions.
That's
it. Would you like to
I just want to add one point here. Now, to classify tumor thrombus according to the extension and the area that has been involved, is quite simplified by your diagram. But the problem is we will not be able to ensure ourselves whether this is something which is a floating thrombus or it is something which is growing into the wall of the vein, maybe the renal vein or the IVC. Once it has embedded into the walls or is infiltrating into the wall, the state changes. Right? So, how you know about this thing? It cannot be judged on a CT scan or a CT angiogram. It can be judged by a properly done MR angiography. But less than that, it is CT angiography. Unless and until you as a clinician and a radiologist, as somebody who is actually the master of the field, are both on the same page, and both of them feel that we want to see this aspect of the thrombus, whether it is something which is floating or it is something which is like a serpent going up to the right atrium. It is something which is going into the wall of the IVC. So there are maybe two or three variations. Then this thing has to be focused clearly, because that changes the plan of surgery. That changes whether you want to spare IVC or you want to take the IVC in totality. You can transect it, you can resect it. The other side of the kidney can be drained by means of lumbar vessels, so there is no problem. There is no point, according to our vascular surgeon, to put in something called IVC graft. So there are many things, many variations which can be done on the basis of definition of the thrombus going into the wall of the vein. So that has to be cleared. It is something which is missed in our protocol. It is something which is missed in our planning. So I've talked about this thing with the radiologists, but they are willing to do it, provided we are with them and they are with us.
Thank you. However, surgical morbidity and mortality does increase in these scenarios due to the procedure being challenging. And perioperative complications of 78%, mortality of 13% have been reported with T3C tumors, tumor thrombosis that are above the diaphragmatic level. As far as the imaging is concerned for the tumor thrombi, MRI with gadolinium provides the best imaging along with the vena cavography, but that is invasive and is not done routinely. Recent evidence suggests that multiplanar CT scan is equally informative. There is a possibility of tumor thrombi acquiring their own vascularization in 35 to 40% of cases. In that scenario, one would like to perform prior renal artery embolization before embarking upon the surgery. These are some of the MRI. I haven't included MRI, but certainly that's an investigation of choice. These are some of the pictures from MRI imaging, tumor thrombus. The other one is this one is also a tumor thrombus with contrast enhancement. As the tumor thrombi tend to expand the renal vessel or the vena cava as in contrast to the bland thrombus. Bland thrombus regions are constricted and appear narrow on the imaging. The other picture of CT scan, bland thrombus is trapped in between two segments of tumor thrombi that have taken up the contrast. Surgical imprints principle.
Again, just a word about this thrombus. If somebody is interested, a point about tumor thrombus is, if the tumor thrombus is actually enhanced on a post-contrast film, same CT scan, then you have to think twice. Because an enhancing thrombus is actually not a thrombus, it's a tumor, right? A thrombus is a bland thrombus if it is not enhancing. But if it is enhancing, then there is again a question mark and an exclamation mark that has to be explained. So if that is the thing, and if you are committed to this topic and this kind of a pathology, you must go back to your radiologist and ask him or her to give further definition of this kind of a problem, because then again, the whole thing changes. This is something which is from the very start is metastatic in nature. For metastatic RCC, now the standard of care is not to go in directly for surgery. It is for something to think about, which is a new adjuvant therapy, maybe TKIs, right? So there are options now. So let's take those options along with the whole pathology. So gone were the days, again, we have to change our practice and the way we think. When we were told that this is something which is radio resistant, this is something which is chemo resistant, there is only one thing available and suitable for renal tumor, and that is surgery. Now you have got options. So let's take those options according to what the criteria are. Right?
Surgical principles of radical nephrectomy. The surgical approach primarily or greatly depends upon the state of the disease process, patient's individual body habitus and prior surgical histories and associated anatomic anomalies, and also the performing surgeon's preference. If you would like to go transperitoneal or retroperitoneal or minimally invasive like laparoscopic or robotic. These are the prime anterior and flank incisions. The most commonest ones that we use for open procedures are thoracoabdominal and subcostal incisions. This one is used for large renal masses, and it can be accessed through 8th, 9th, 10th, or 11th rib, depending upon the size of the tumor or the associated venous tumor presence and extension. This is a transperitoneal incision, bilateral subcostal, and is used for renovascular surgery. For example, if there is accompanying level 3 thrombus of the IVC, would not be able to resect from a flank approach.
The beauty of this approach and the incision is it can be progressed to two directions or proceeded. One is the upper one, the kephalad. By that you make this incision, which is actually a bilateral chevron. into something like a Mercedes incision. And then that is called sternotomy. So if you want to take out, for instance, there is a thrombus in IVC and it is going behind the liver, then what you can do is you have to open up a little bit of thorax. You have to open the diaphragm intentionally. You don't just injure the diaphragm. You cut it precisely with the knife, right? And then it will be easier for you to just do the repair afterwards. So basically, every incision has to be done so that it can be again proceeded, maybe extended. If that incision is there and if you want to say go up, you have got an advantage here.
Most of the surgical steps you guys are already familiar with, the prime principles that are to be taken care of, that gallbladder and liver are not to be injured. Although with thoracoabdominal approaches, pleura is to be incised, but lung injury can be avoided and should be avoided. Early renal vascular control is the basic principle of any tumor surgery regarding the kidneys, and minimal handling of the kidney and associated vessels would lead to less chances of thromboembolic events due to the tumor thrombus dislodgement. Regional lymph node dissection, we have discussed briefly priorly, the paracaval, precaval, retrocaval, and interaorticaval lymph nodes are to be dissected from the crest of diaphragm to the bifurcation of IVC if they are to be dissected. Gonadal vein is to be ligated during this dissection, and lumbar veins and lymphatic veins, lymphatic channels are also to be compromised.
Again, if you know the vascular supply of adrenal, it's very easy. On the right side, the adrenal vein goes directly into the IVC. On the left side, it goes into the renal vein. So if there is a thrombus on the left side in the renal vein, you got to take the adrenal, no matter how small, how big, where the tumor is in the kidney. You've got to take the adrenal, because adrenal vein, you are not sure. It is of a very small caliber. You cannot be sure that this tumor thrombus is not going retrogradely into the adrenal vein. So you've got to take it out. On the right side, you have got the option. You can leave it behind because there is a separate drainage for right adrenal, right? So all this knowledge and information that we gather right from our, undergraduate level to this level, it all has to be implemented. No matter whether it is written in the books or not, it is something to make it happen on the table for the patient. So if common sense is there, it has to prevail.
For left-sided tumors, interaorticaval nodes are resected only if they are palpable or visualized to be larger on preoperative imaging. Now, vena caval thrombectomy. The preoperative considerations, the important ones to consider before you embark upon a tumor thrombectomy. Low molecular weight heparin has potential benefits of reducing the risk of pulmonary embolism and dislodgement of tumor thrombus, and also, according to some studies, has a role in shrinking and prevention of the progression of gland thrombus. The role of IVC filters, like the Greenfield filters, is still uncertain. Preoperative angioembolization is not strongly recommended, as it was associated with increased operating time, increased blood loss, increased hospital stay, and perioperative mortality in patients with T3 tumors. Use of per-op transesophageal echocardiography is recommended to be sure of the cranial extension of the tumor thrombus before you perform sternotomy or atriotomy. A vascular surgeon is to be consulted if the urologist is not familiar with handling the vascular channels for level 2 and level 1 thrombi. And for level 3 and 4, preoperative cardiothoracic surgeon's consultation is mandatory. The surgical method you go about for the tumor thrombi is actually dependent upon two factors. First is the level of tumor thrombus, and second is the grade of IVC occlusion, like if it is completely occluded or partially. We will discuss them one by one. For level 0 and 1 thrombectomy, there is not much difference. do you perform the radical nephrectomy routinely as we do? There is a chance of 12% involvement of a renal vein and 2% involvement of vena cava for level 1 thrombus in association with the renal mass. They are usually partially occlusive, they are non-adherent, and do not require extensive IVC dissection. They can routinely be treated in a similar fashion. Level 1 can be routinely treated in a similar fashion to level 0. Avoid extensive renal vein manipulation, as we have already discussed. So what we do is apply a Sutinsky clamp once we have taken the vascular control and mobilized IVC enough, and incise the vena cava, incise the renal vein, and take out the thrombus in toto and repair the vessel in two layers.
Now, if I ask somebody, what is the advantage of putting in a Sutinsky clamp? Can anybody answer? Anybody? Aisha, are you there?
So there are several advantages of applying vascular clamps. One is in achieving hemostasis. It will help us in repairing it appropriately because we'll have a clear feel when we are repairing it after incising the vein. Secondly, it helps in limiting the thrombi. It will prevent it from propagating upwards or downwards. That's the second advantage of applying a vascular clamp.
Yes. And more so because you see there is an angulation here, and that angulation is here in Sutinsky clamp, but you can have a straight clamp also. If you want to use a straight clamp, the disadvantage is it will cause cross clamping, meaning to say the whole vessel will be blocked.
Clamped.
Right. What we want here is to have something called partial clamping. Partial clamping can always be done with a Sutinsky clamp. It cannot be done with a straight clamp, because if you want to have a straight clamp, then it will be obliquely placed and there will be a little bit of vein that is actually injured. So you see the two lips, the upper, the proximal one and the distal one, they are out of the field, and the field which you want to stitch is just in front of you. The rest of the blood can be shunted away from this place, right? So this is what is the advantage of using Sutinsky clamp.
There is a 3% incidence of level 2 thrombi in association with RCC. Chevron incision provides best access for this level of the thrombus because you would like to perform as you would like to gain a proper venous control before performing tumor thrombectomy. Like in this picture that has been depicted, for example, there is a left-sided tumor. One would need to take control of the IVC intra-renal and suprarenal along with the contralateral renal vein. This clamping is important because you do not want to get your thrombus dislodged into the contralateral kidney. So the method of sequential clamping is that intrarenal IVC is clamped first, followed by the contralateral renal vein, and last by the suprarenal IVC. The vessels are taken on a rubber catheter and then clamped, followed by the incision in the renal vein and IVC. Tumor is extracted and the defect is repaired. Then another important point that I want to stress upon is that the removal of these clamps is also sequential. One needs to remove the infrarenal IVC clamp first because you want to get rid of the remaining tumor debris and the air, which will later on can cause air embolism and remaining tumor thrombus, followed by the contralateral renal vein and suprarenal IVC clamping. Before you tie a knot, you need to remove the infrarenal IVC clamp and let 5 to 10 ml of blood to bleed through the defect. In case of left renal tumors, contralateral renal artery needs to be clamped sometimes. Can anybody tell me why is it important sometimes? Because as Dr. Asad has mentioned already, the left kidney has a better venous drainage through lumbar, through gonadal, and through adrenal veins, which the right kidney is not blessed with. So in order to prevent that engorgement, you may want to intermittently or temporarily clamp the renal artery as well, right renal artery.
Okay, you can clamp it or you can have a kind of a loop, which is a double loop, and it's a softer the structure and the vessel wall is has got an integrity with that thing. So there are other means of doing it. So yes, it is clamping, but not with the with the instrument.
Yeah. Level 3 and 4 vena cava thrombi are more extensive and need more extensive surgeries. There are two approaches to go about these tumors. One is completely intra-abdominal. Most level 3 thrombi can be controlled or excised with this approach, but some of the level 3 and mostly most of the level 4 thrombi will need a combined approach like intra-abdominal and intrathoracic with or without cardiopulmonary bypass. I had already mentioned that the technique that you go with is actually based upon two things, the level of the thrombus and the level of occlusion of IVC. Patients with completely occlusive thrombi have already developed a collateral system. So in those patients, it is easier to clamp suprahepatic IVC without much compromise to their cardiopulmonary reserves, or there is a less chance of hypertension while you are performing the thrombectomy. But those who have partially occlusive IVC will not be able to tolerate suprahepatic IVC clamping. For those, you need to perform infrahepatic IVC clamping, and you may need to put your patient on bypass. Pringle's maneuver is necessary when you perform suprahepatic clamping because the blood flow is actually coming into the liver through the porta hepatis and is not able to drain through the hepatic veins because you have clamped the suprahepatic IVC. So you need to temporarily clamp the porta hepatis as well, and that is called Pringle's maneuver.
Just repeat this Pringle's maneuver.
Porta hepatis is to be clamped when suprahepatic IVC is clamped because the blood is coming into the liver through all in portal vein and is not able to drain through the hepatic veins because you have already clamped the suprahepatic IVC above the level of hepatic veins.
Yes, and I'm happy that you have mentioned it here because this is something which has to be learned by all those who want to put their fingers into the field of liver, for instance. So if you happen to be a general surgeon doing hepatectomy or doing something called a liver transplant, this maneuver has to be learned. Again, if you are a urologist, you want to do something into the field of the liver, you must know how to deal with, how to imply Pringle's maneuver. So that is important. Thank you.
Porta hepatis clamping should be minimized to a maximum of 20 minutes because longer clamping will lead to hepatic dysfunction postoperatively and deranged liver enzymes. Accessory hepatic veins can be safely ligated to gain further access. Sequential clamping is applied in a similar manner to remove the thrombi that are more Kevlar'd and away from your field of dissection. A Fogarty balloon catheter and 20 FR poly catheter can also be used. Liver is to be tucked back after the IVC repair because this type of surgery requires complete right lobe liver mobilization, including the dissection of falciparum, coronary, and triangular ligaments. So you need to tuck it back to prevent its torsion. For level 4 thrombi, most of the level 4 thrombi need the help of a cardiothoracic surgeon. He would perform a right atriotomy, and a bypass is necessary most of the times. If an a tumor thrombus present in the right atrium can be milled down, this one, a clamp would be sufficient here, and patient would not need to go under a venovenous or a cardiopulmonary bypass. But if it is you are not able to milk it downwards, you would have to open the atrium, and that would need a bypass to maintain a blood-free field.
Now, I want to share a dream with you. That was a dream of myself, that throughout my career, I should be able to do something like this, the picture which is or the diagram which is shown here. But I haven't done it. So that was a dream which wasn't come true. And I think it's a dream which your generation and maybe Pardeep can do it. So. I don't know. You can be the 13th one. 13 is a bad figure. Yes, that was a dream. So maybe I was living the dream of Professor Rizvi, so, but I haven't done it.
So how you do it? Venovenous bypass. One venous access can be taken to the through the femoral or the vena cava. But if you are taking access through the vena cava, you need to remain away from the tumor thrombus or the bland thrombus that can be present here. The other venous access is taken from the internal jugular or the atrium if you have opened it. You put the patient on venovenous bypass and you clamp the IVC and this renal vein that I've mentioned already to keep this field blood free. One problem with this bypass is that you are unable to clamp the intercostal and lumbar vessels, and that can cause bleeding. Cardiopulmonary bypass provides an additional benefit. With cardiopulmonary bypass, you can put the patient on deep hypothermic arrest. Like, your patient will be in hypothermia for 30 minutes on a temperature of about 60 to 20 degrees Celsius. This will not lead to organ damage, and it gives you more time, like more than 30 minutes are available for the surgeon to perform thrombectomy. Plus, this entire field will be bloodless because your patient will be essentially exsanguinated for the time period. And the blood circulation is actually cooled down. That's how you decrease the body temperature. And once you have completed your thrombectomy in the given time, you rewarm the blood and start infusing it again.
And how you start the heart again?
You stop the cardioplegics.
And? One thing more.
Stop the pump.
You give the heart a little bit of jerk by means of the pads. So it's the same thing as cardio resuscitation, right? And you use the defibrillator. Rather than defibrillating, you're actually giving the fibrillation. So heart first starts fibrillating and then picks up the normal pacemaker activity. Okay. So you give the heart a little bit of jerk, an electrical jerk.
Although radical nephrectomy is a traditional procedure, and nowadays we're performing partial, and that too has now shifted towards the laparoscopic and robotic procedures. But the recent thing that I could find, and is a thing that is being done for the last 4 or 5 years, and there are not many cases reported so far. According to this study that was done in 2016, a series of 25 patients that were carefully selected underwent a robotic surgery with tumor thrombectomy up to level 3 thrombi were successfully removed, and the patients were followed for a period of 16 months, and all of them were alive and doing fine, and surgical margins were also negative. Only one patient needed to undergo open procedure due to some technical problems. If you are able to compromise 50% of the IVC lumen while you are performing tumor thrombectomy, but more than that needs to be repaired with a patch or complete vena cable replacement. For a patch, there are many materials available, autologous or bovine pericardium, or there is polytetrafluoroethylene graft that we commonly use in our vascular surgeries. Collagen impregnated dacron or autologous saphenous vein is also used. If there is a segment that cannot be repaired with a patch, it has to be replaced with usually artificial material. Like in this one, there is a PDFE graft. A larger diameter graft is to be implanted, and that is to be made sure, because a narrower graft would further hamper the vascular drainage and would cause further thrombosis. And the patient is to be kept on low molecular weight heparin perioperatively and lifelong warfarin to maintain an INR of 2 to 3. The common perioperative complications are air embolism, and how we can prevent it, we have discussed already, by letting a few ml of blood to bleed through the IVC defect. The chances of acute pulmonary embolism are there by the dislodgement of tumor thrombi that can be reduced by minimal handling of the kidney and the veins before you have achieved vascular control and taken your vessels onto the loops. Massive hemorrhage is a possibility because you are opening up the large caliber vessels. When the patient is put on cardiopulmonary bypass, those channels are heparinized, and they can further lead to coagulopathies. So FFPs, fresh frozen plasma, platelets, blood products are to be transfused liberally. Hepatic dysfunction is a side effect of clamping porta hepatis for a longer period or clamping suprahepatic IVC. But essentially, most of these patients improve in 2 to 3 weeks. organ ischemia, like if the other contralateral kidney is compromised already, or clamping it for longer period, or cardiac exsanguination can cause organ ischemia, but that's rare. Follow-up, we perform follow-up of radical nephrectomy patients to identify post-op complications and to follow the pattern of renal function and to see if there are, is a local reoccurrence or patient is developing any METs, the reoccurrence of the tumor in contralateral kidney. There are two scorings or two sort of nomograms that are most widely used to follow the patients. One is the Mayo Clinic. This one includes the stage of the tumor, the size, grade, and necrosis score, and classify them into a score. This chart predicts that patients with a score of 10 or higher have a zero predictability of 5-year cancer-free survival, and patients with lesser score have a better prognosis. Another one is from the California University. This one incorporates the ECOG status, which the previous study was not has not included. The grading, tumor grading, and the ECOG status, the combination of these two would segregate your patients into low risk, intermediate, or high risk, and that way you can predict the overall survival. For example, if it's 84% in low risk and 72% in intermediate and worse in higher grades. A general pattern that is included in the EUA guidelines 2020. This one proposes since once you have segregated your patients in low and intermediate risk, that is how you can go about with the radiological follow-up. For example, the low-risk patients at 6 months ultrasound should suffice, 1 year CT scan followed by a 2 year interval of CT scan. But for high-risk patients, ultrasounds and x-rays are not to be relied upon, and a regular CT scan should be the way to go forward. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Excellent. I think you go back to the slide where you were actually showing us the article. It's this one. This one. You see, there is a name which is Inderbir Gill. So if anybody wants to learn about this thing and want to be excited, just follow this man, Inderbir Gill. He is still a professor of urology in University of Southern California. And his contribution to the field of uro-oncology, surgical uro-oncology, is mind-boggling. So he has turned the table from open surgery to laparoscopy to advanced laparoscopy to robotics now, to thrombectomy through the platform of robotics. So if you want to learn something, learn from Inderbir Gill. There are lectures available in his name also. And mind you, he started laparoscopy in a model which is a bovine model. So he started something in a cow, and that was pyeloplasty. So his dream was actually something which turned him a very proficient surgeon. Still, he is doing surgeries. So thank you very much.
Thank you.